love you, Joe, and just honor you and appreciate you. You're a great friend. Come and share with us today what God has placed in your heart. Amen.
Thank you very much. I'm so happy because I am sharing with a group of people that have Jesus in their heart. I'm sharing with a group of people that have decided to serve Jesus. I'm sharing with a group of people that have the joy of the Lord in their heart and in their life. And so this is the most wonderful thing that any preacher could do. What I like to share with you today is found in the book of Nehemiah, chapter 8, verse 10. I will only look at the last paragraph of this particular verse. And it says like this: "For the joy of the Lord is your strength." The joy of the Lord is your strength. If you do not have joy, you do not have strength. Just one of those things, is it? Now, if you look at the particular background in which this verse was written, you will find that the people of Israel had been in bondage for many, 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 many years. And many of that generation would stand and they would cry out to God for a rebuilding of the city of Jerusalem and the rebuilding of the temple. There was a desire in their heart that the temple would be restored and rebuilt so that they could come with joy to bring gifts unto the Lord. The temple was not going to be built there so that they could get something except the presence of the Lord, but the temple was there so that they with joy could bring something into the presence of God. They wanted to see God moving, something like the church in Kawana. They want to see something moving in this area in where we are. We see a lot of destructed houses, we see a lot of walls within churches which have been destroyed and turned down, and we are looking at it and we are saying, well, Lord, you can only do it, and you can do it if you give us the strength and the power to do so. That group of people was ready and willing to do what God wanted them to do, that is to rebuild the house of God. We must have in our mind the desire of building the house of God. The house of God is the church where we are coming together. The house of God is the place where we are coming to meet day after day, week after week, and therefore we must have the joy and the desire in rebuilding the house of God. I cannot build the house of God by staying home. I cannot build the house of God by putting my hands in my pocket. I cannot build the house of God by sitting down and doing nothing. To build the house of God, it takes strength, it takes desire, it takes determination, it takes willpower, and most of all, it takes the joy of the Lord. That's the only way we can rebuild the house of God. That's the only way we will be able to build the house of God. I was thinking the other day, and do you know that God does not know sadness? He's never been exposed to sadness. The only way God knows sadness, it is because Jesus came to this world and he dealt with us. Now he knows what sadness is all about. And when he looks down from heaven, he knows exactly what you're going through, what I am going through. So to rebuild the house of God, or to rebuild the house of God in our spiritual life, we must have a goal. We must have a plan. We must have something that we do. I remember the conference, Phil was talking about financial things, and he said, if you want to prosper in your financial situation, you must have a goal, and you must also have a plan. and you write down that plan in a piece of paper, you write down that goal in a piece of paper, you put it in your pocket, and every so often you take it out and you read it. And I believe that in our spiritual life, thank you, Phil, I believe that in our spiritual life, we are exactly in the same situation. We must have a goal. You cannot get up in the morning and say, I wonder what am I going to do today besides scratching my head. I mean, you have to have a goal for that day. That day has to start in your life with a goal and a plan, and a plan. And the plan of the people of God is to be able to help those who are surrounding around about them. We must help them. That is the first plan that we must have. The goal is to have souls saved for the kingdom of God. That is our goal. And it's the most important goal that we must have. The joy of the Lord is what comes to us no matter where we are and no matter what we do. We don't have to win the slaughter to have joy. That is not joy. That is something that you feel happy. It's happiness for a moment. Joy is not happiness. Joy is something more deep. It comes stronger than just happiness. Happiness is when I look at somebody and I say, oh, hi there, I'm happy. And then I'm happy because I feel well, I'm well, I just had coffee, and then everything seems to be going well, and everything is well. But happiness is when I go into the deepest of the valley, and down there I'm able to sing unto the Lord and to praise unto the Lord. That is joy, which comes from the Spirit of God. You want proof? I'll give you some proof. Do you remember my brother Paul? He had a brother called Silas. Suddenly they were preaching the gospel, and what happened to them? They were taken, they were beaten. Blood was coming out from all over the place. They were put chains in their hands, and they were thrown to the deepest part of the prison. Not the top, but the deepest part of the prison, because they were dangerous prisoners. Now there they are, on the floor. Blood was still coming out. The hands were chained and the feet were chained. They couldn't really move that fast. But I don't know which one, Paul or Silas, I don't know which one, but one of them opened his eyes, and he looked at the other one, his brother, and he said, let's say that was Silas. He said, hey, Paul, aren't we privileged? We have chains, we are broken, we are all bad, feeling and everything else, but we are because we have been made conformable to the Jesus Christ our Lord. Isn't that a wonderful thing? That we are able to suffer because of the kingdom of God. Now, give me a Christian who will cry out and say, I'm glad that I'm suffering because of the Lord Jesus Christ. But they were. The point is, they get results. So what happened? Paul turned around. Supposing that was Silas talking to Paul or vice versa. I think it was Paul talking to Silas because he had a big mouth. He talked more than Silas ever did, so it must have been him. So he said, well, you know what? Thank God that we are here in jail for the cause of the Lord Jesus Christ. And as soon as they say that, they begin to rejoice. The joy of the Lord began to come into their heart. The chains began to move by themselves. And the joy of the Lord began to have a song in their heart and in their life. The song went all through the prison, went up to the very presence of God. God heard that song from up there. He looked down and he said, as he said, that is Paul and Silas, something happened. Because when God speaks, something always happens. And at that moment, when God spoke, an earthquake came, and the chains were broken down, and the prison was open. Because when God speaks, things happen. Things happen. Oh, and the chain was broken. And you see, the point is that they were there for the kingdom of God. And you know what happened at the end of the story? You know it. The jailers were trying to kill himself, and Paul said, don't kill yourself, we are all here, and blah, 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 blah. So he took them over and he's asking a lot of questions. I love when people come and ask questions, because then you can give them the answers. And when they start asking questions, that day, the whole household accepted the Lord as their own Savior. And the household in those days could be 40, 50 people, by the way, because there were the wives, and there was the husband, the wives, the brothers, and the sisters, and the kids, and the kids, and the kids, and the servant, and the servants of the servant. So it could easily be 40, 50 people. And they were all added up to the church that one day, because somebody had the joy of the Lord, and they began to scream praises unto the Lord, and the Lord answered from heaven. That's I remember when I said at the conference when my mother was in jail. I laugh about it, but it's not really to laugh about it. It's not nice to go to jail. And they were down there, so a number of people, ladies, they were all in one room, and they began to, they were in jail. What do you do? You feel sorry for yourself. That's the last natural thing to do. When you are in trouble, what you do? You feel sorry for yourself. That was the world does. Christians don't do that. So we have no right of feeling sorry for ourselves. So the next time that you feel sorry for yourself, remind yourself that you have no right of feeling sorry for yourself. And don't tell me that, yeah, but you don't know my problem. I don't have to know your problem. Because I am an ambassador here. And the ambassador is not subject to the law of this country. The ambassador is subject to the law of the country in which he represents. And if I am Christ justified and saved, I'm a citizen of heaven. And I represent the citizen of heaven, the citizenship of heaven. Therefore, whatever the world can bring to me, it means nothing. Because I'm not subject to that law. Okay, so what did they do, those ladies? They had nothing else to do, but they start singing. Thing is that when you start praising and singing, something happened. Something happened. The joy of the Lord comes from down here. And so they began to sing and praising and shouting and yelling, and one of the younger ladies said, isn't that nice? We never done this before. Because every time we open up our mouth, that we had to be afraid for the police to come and put us in jail. He said, but isn't that wonderful? We are already in jail. So we can do nothing else for us. Let us sing and praise and give thanks unto the Lord. On the other side of the room, by the way, the other side of the jail was another member of my family. It was my uncle there. Because he was a businessman, they threw him in a solitary prison, not together with the others, but by themselves, by himself. And he, when he came into the jail, the prison, whatever, the room, whatever you want to call it, he realized that the room was damp, and my uncle always suffered with asthma, and therefore, in the few, didn't take long for that humidity to come and choke his breathing, and he couldn't breathe anymore. He banged at the door, he wanted help. Sent a doctor, some medicine, something. I'm suffering with asthma, I'm dying, I can't breathe. The man from the other side, he opened the little window, he looked at him, he said, don't worry about it, when you're dead, we'll bury you. And so there he was, all by himself, and he couldn't do much. So he went and he lay down, and he asked to the Lord, Lord, I'm here because of you. I'm here because I'm serving you. I am dying. If this is the time for me to come home, please, Lord, take care of my children. Take care of my wife. I am ready to come. And I'm joyful if you want to call me. I'm full of joy to come and be with you forevermore. My uncle said he fell asleep. In the morning he woke up, he didn't have any more pain. He could breathe just as normal as anybody else. He never had from that time on any attack of asthma anymore. When he got out of the prison, he went to a town not far from Rome and the surrounding of Rome. He started a church, and by the time he died, he had a church going on for the kingdom of God. God can do things. Yes, he can. God can do and he can move. The joy of the Lord that is upon you, he can interfere with the people who are completely on the other side. When the joy of the Lord comes into your life, he can interfere for those who are away from you. We must have a plan. That's what my brother said. You must have a plan, and you must know what you're doing. So one day, one of the old men came to me and he said, Joseph, I said, what? He said, I can see that you're going to be in the ministry one day, but he said, there is one thing I want you to remember. I said, what's that? He said, that the death, the joy of the Lord direct your ministry. Let the joy of the Lord direct your ministry. For whatever that is the joy, the ministry of the Lord is working much easier and much better. Wherever there is a joy in the church, there is revival in the church. Wherever there is joy in the individual, there is goodness all around your house, your home, and everything else. So we have a plan. Let's have a plan this morning. Let us make a goal and have a plan. On Sunday is the day of the Lord. I am going to church. I make a plan. I am going to go to church. It makes no difference where I'm going, but I'm going to go to church. I have decided that the Sunday is the day of the Lord. And because it is the day of the Lord, I will, nothing else will interfere from me to go into the house of God. When my father and mother used to go to the house of God, which was only a house meeting somewhere, my mother would give me a telephone number. And it's because I was the oldest in the family. She'll give me the telephone number, and she would say, in case we are not coming back home tonight, because we have been arrested, I want you to call tomorrow morning this number, and somebody will come and take care of you. There were all kids like that. And somebody will come and take care of you. Do you think that because your group would go to jail, they were going to interfere with them to go to church? My friend, we are not going to church if the wind blows. We are not going to church if it's raining. We are not going to church if there is snow. Any excuse is good enough for not going to the house of the Lord. And then we want a revival. We will never have a revival anywhere. Sunday is the defense of the Lord. And I love God with all my heart, with all my life. And therefore, I am going to decide that Sunday is the day of the Lord, and I'm going to go to church. Even if I go over there and fall asleep. It makes a difference. By you being there, you are an encouragement to the others who are coming in. By you sitting in that chair, other people will come in and they will say, this church is on fire for God because the people are not staying home. They are coming to church. And it's also a testimony to the people outside. Because if you, when they said, oh, we are going to the races. He said, oh, sorry, I'm going to church. They said, man, the church must be even better than the races. Of course it is. Of course it is. But the people will not know unless we do it. So let's make a plan this morning. Let us make a plan in our life. Let us make a plan in our goals and a goal for God. It is time to go to church. I am going to go to church. Tonight, we'll have a full quiz. Why? Because the day is dedicated to God. The day is dedicated for the glory of God. And I have made a plan, and that plan is not going to change. And I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Sunday is the Lord's day. We are going to the house of God with joy. Monday. What am I going to do on Monday? Let us make a goal. Sunday is the day of the Lord. Monday, I don't have to go to church because it's Monday. I went to church yesterday. On Monday, I made up my mind. I'm going to get out of bed full of joy.
Yeah.
Why am I full of joy? It is Monday. Monday, according to the world, is a great day. But for the Christian, it is a day full of joy. Why is a day full of joy? I'll tell you why. Because 1 week is past. All my mistakes are gone. All my troubles are gone. All my problems are gone. Sunday was in between. I went to the house of God. Everything has been left behind. Now it is Monday. And He offered to me a brand new week, a brand new day, and a brand new week where I can do an exploit for God, the things that God wants me to do and what He has called me to do. Let us make a plan today. Let us write it down in a piece of paper. Monday, I'm going to be full of joy because it's a new day. It's a new offer. It's a new opportunity. Last week is gone and the problems are gone. But before me, there is a new territory to conquer.
Amen.
Write it down. That's Monday. Did he say it was exciting to be a Christian?
Yeah.
What am I going to do on Tuesday? Pick up a piece of paper. This is Tuesday. So I have to make a goal for Tuesday. Because of what happened on Sunday and Monday, Tuesday I'm full of vigor. I am just full of it. And no matter what comes against me, they cannot destroy it because the vigor of the Lord is there in my heart. They cannot touch it because it's down deep here. They can put me in jail, they can cut my head, but they cannot take it because it's here. It's down here in my heart. Therefore, Tuesday, it is the day that I am full of vigor and full of victory because I am into the presence of the Lord. I'm going to walk into the presence of the Lord. Wednesday and Thursday, let us get them together. Otherwise, we're going to go too far. Let us, Wednesday and Thursday, I am walking in the light. I have made up my mind. I have decided, I'll write down on the paper, so be written, so be done. Wednesday and Thursday, I'm going to walk in the light. Everything that is good, I walk right through. Everything that is shady, I'll walk away. Everything that is good, I'll speak about it. Everything that is shady, I say nothing about it. It's not my business. I have nothing to do. On Wednesday, I walk into the light. I walk into the light of God. In every decision that I will make, I will ask, what would Jesus do if He was in my place? What He would do if He was here? I will do the right thing. In all things, and even if it will cost me anything, I will still do what is glorify the name of the Lord. When I was called in the army, my army man is not here today, but when I was called into the army, I was called. I didn't go by because I wanted to go, I was called in there. And so I had to serve. And everybody was telling me that the army was going to be a very difficult, bad place to be in, and all the temptation, and all the things, and all the Christians coming and put their hands on you, shaking you up, and trying to help you, and whatever. So I went into the army. I didn't have my uniform yet, but 2 days later, I was called, and they said to me, he said, you are on duty tomorrow morning. And I said, did I say that before? I said, I'm on duty, that you're on duty tomorrow morning. And so I said, okay. He said, be ready at a certain time. The crew meets over there. And what did they give to me? A very bad job. They told me, you go in front of everybody else. Everything that is under the beds, you just put them on top of the beds so that the people coming behind, they can easily go through and clean up and whatever. And I was doing that. I found under the bed a wallet, a nice big wallet, bigger than what I got. And when I looked at it, there was a lot of money in it. And I said, well, I have to do something with it. I took, I called up the corporal that was on duty and I said, come over. And he said, what happened? They said, I found the wallet. He looked at me like if I was a nun, because he said, put it in your pocket. What the heck are you telling me for? You know? I mean, what's the problem? I said, oh no, I don't do that. So I said, I want you to count the money and then report it, whatever has to be done. So he did. In that afternoon, I had a lieutenant, all nice in uniform, coming to my place. And he said, are you to Roma? I said, yes. Do you have a uniform? I said, yes, I got one yesterday. He said, put it on, the captain wants to see you. I said, what the captain wants to see me? I haven't done anything. He said, well, he wants to see you. So I got dressed up, I went out, we marched into the captain's office, and as soon as the lieutenant got in, he said to the captain, he said, sir, this is Joe Roma. So the captain got up from the chair, he came out from behind the desk, he came to me and he said, I am happy to have an honest soldier in my troop. Oh, I said, that's nice. Oh, he said, sit down, sit down. They don't tell you to sit down, you know, but he did say sit down to it. So I sat there and he started asking me questions. And I told him that I was a Christian and therefore I could not possess something that didn't belong to me. See, you have to do the right thing, even when it doesn't seem the right thing to be nicely for you to do it, but you've got to do it. And so I did it. And he was happy about it, and so we talked about it. He asked me why I didn't take the money. I said, because I'm a Christian. And as a Christian, and so I started giving him my testimony, telling him what I came from and everything else, and he wanted to know more about the Lord. And then time went by, and he said, okay, thank you very much, and I went back. When I went back, before the end of the week, the lieutenant came back again. And he said, Joe Roma, I said, yes. He said, Sunday morning, I want you to wear your new uniform and I come and pick you up. We are going to see the colonel. Oh, I said, oh, brother, another one. So, Sunday morning, see, Sunday morning, in the Italian army at that time, everybody will march into the main square and there is a Catholic mass, the priest come and have a mass there. And that's something that they do. They didn't ask me because they knew I wasn't a Catholic, so they didn't bother with me. But when we went, the ceremony was over, the captain and the lieutenant, one on one side, one on the other, and I stood in the middle. We marched up to the podium where the colonel was. I went up to the podium with them, and the captain stood in attention and greeted, and then he said, sir, this is Joe Roma. And the colonel came to me and he said, oh, I'm glad to know you and to know that I have an honest man among all of these thousands of people here. That's a thousand people there with. And so he turned around and he said to the captain, he said, what did you give Joe Roma for a present for what he's done? Well, he said, I don't know, sir. He said, but I was thinking that you would send him home for Christmas. Now, the first 3 months that you are in the army, you just forget about your home. You just don't go home. That's it. Because you are under training. And therefore, nobody ever in the history of the army has ever went home 3 months before, within those 3 months. But that day, I had 5 days, the trip day, and to go home for Christmas. 5 days at home, 2 days for trip, and all the expenses paid. You do the right thing. And God will make a way for you. God will always honor what you do that comes back for His glory and for His kingdom. Therefore, on Thursday and Wednesday and Thursday, I'm walking in the light. I am decided to do what is good for God, not what is good for me, and what is good for the kingdom of God. Friday is coming soon, and Friday is the day in which I live in victory, because it reminds me that Jesus died on the cross, and He died on the cross and He saved me, and therefore I am walking in the victory. Make a plan for Friday. Friday, you're going to walk in victory, because Jesus died on the cross, but He did the victory, and give you the power to in that day. Make a plan. Write it down on the paper. Take the paper out every so often and remind yourself that Friday is the day in which God, in which Jesus has given me what I have today. On Saturday, I make up my mind. Saturday, I walk in delight. Write it down. Saturday is my delight. You know why? Because I can sit back, have a cup of coffee, and think of all the beautiful things that Jesus done through me, by me, in me, through all of that week. Oh, I walk in delight. I walk in delight. Am I full of delight? Yes, sir. I'm joy, and the joy of the Lord keep coming and coming and keep coming again. And so I'm thinking, and everything that I'm thinking for the week that is gone, I will put it together so that when I come the following day, that is Sunday, I come to meet with my brothers and my sister. I will share with them my testimony. I will tell them this week has been a wonderful week, and I have it written down here. It is a week in full of glory, full of expectation, full of the presence of the Lord, and I want to share with everybody else so you know exactly what you're going to say on Sunday morning. Make a plan. Take a piece of paper. Make a plan. And let that plan. Jesus said in John 15, I told you these things. Why? So that my joy might be filled in you. I told you these things. Now, I'm closing here. Not because I'm running out of things, but I'm running out of sin. There is a jingle that probably might help in closing down. It's a jingle which actually is a song. It's a little chorus which you can sing every so often if you learn it. You sing it through the day, keep reminding you of the paper that you wrote and that are in your pocket. The jingle goes this way. On Sunday, I am happy. On Monday, I'm full of joy. On Tuesday, full of vigor that nothing can destroy. On Wednesday and on Thursday, I'm walking in the light. On Friday, I have victory. On Saturday, delight. And it goes like this. On Sunday, I am happy. On Monday, full of joy. On Tuesday, full of vigor that nothing can destroy. On Wednesday and on Thursday, I'm walking in the light. On Friday, I'm in victory. And on Saturday, delight. Oh, glory, glory, glory. Oh, glory to the Lamb. Oh, hallelujah, I am saved and I know I'm sure I am. Oh, glory, glory, glory. Oh, glory to the Lamb. Oh, hallelujah, I am saved and I know I'm sure I am. Write it down on your paper. Make a plan of your own. And make a seat. Because you are a child of God. And nothing can interfere with you doing the work of the Lord. For that's what God wants you to do. Let us say.